Grace and peace to you as we are gathered for worship today across time and space. And we are gathered for worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And would you please pray with me? Loving God, today we're gathered in so many places physically, as well as so many places emotionally. On this day when much of our country may feel like it's at a boiling point, with the cry for racial justice, with cries from suffering from a pandemic that continues to be ongoing, we ask for your Spirit to intercede for us. We ask for you to move in our individual hearts, in your church, and in this world that you so dearly love. Would you please hold us and teach us to listen and to love one another as you have first loved us? And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, welcome. We're so glad that you are here joining with us today. We are actually starting a new series called Normal Doesn't Live Here Anymore. And each and every day, I think that becomes more and more evident. And so today, we'll be hearing a message from Pastor Tim that will be highlighting how some things that have been normal should never have been normal. And before we get too far into that, though, we have a couple of things that we would like you to know. And first of all, we have a new way of connecting as a church community. And you will see that there is a phone number up there for you, which you can text a single word to. You can text welcome. And if this is your first time joining us, or perhaps you've been kind of watching with us for a few times now, but you feel perhaps comfortable to find out some more about us, you can text welcome to that number and you will get a text back that gives you some more information. Alternatively, you can text the word prayer if you would like to share a prayer request. We are a community that really loves to be praying with you and for you, so you can text prayer to us. That number again is up there for you, 602-806-9406. And that is just one of the ways that we can be continuing to stand together and praying with each other and for each other. So with all those notes, as we prepare to move into a time of offering, we thank you so much for your generosity and your support, which is empowering us to continue to follow God's mission for this world. And so we'll have a number of ways that you can continue to give. They'll be up there on the screen for you. You can mail a check into our physical location. You can also text your gift. You can use the QR code by holding a camera phone up and using the QR code, or you can always visit our website at www.boldrecklessgrace.org, and you'll find all the information you need there on our website to grab to help you lead you through that process. And so as we prepare to move into a time of offering and being generous, we have a special video from our New Generation group for you to enjoy.
Where you call your home. Don't know where you eat your meals or where you talk on the phone. Don't know if you've got a cook, a butler or a maid. Don't know if you've got a yard with a hammock in the shade.
Come and go with me to my Father's house. Come and go with me to my Father's house. It's a big, big house with lots and lots of room. Lots and lots of food. A big, big yard where we can play football.
Touchdown!
A big, big house is my Father's house. A big, big house with lots and lots of room. A big, big table with lots and lots of food. A big, big yard where we can play football.
Touchdown!
A big, big house. It's my Father's house. It's a big,
well, I want to add my own welcome to each and every one of you as we worship together here at Community of Grace. We're on the campus of Community of Grace Lutheran Church here in Peoria, Arizona. And we're so glad you're joining us, whether it's on Facebook or YouTube. My name is Tim Wright. I am the senior pastor here. And this is such an important time in our history, so it's really good for us to be together as we worship. Now, I've been a pastor for 36 years, and some of you have been a part of my pastorate for almost that long. At least my wife has. She's been with me for 36 years, and many of you have been with me for several decades. Some of you have been a part of our mission together for a month, maybe a few years, several years. But in that time, we have been through many, many big moments in our history together. I remember back in 1986, it was a Friday evening, and I was supposed to be having dinner with my wife and my kids and my in-laws, but I had ripped up my sermon for that week and was writing a new sermon to talk about the Space Shuttle Challenger. I remember that moment when Bill Clinton came out and finally admitted to his affair with Monica Lewinsky, and I was preaching that weekend and had to talk about that particular issue. That day in 2001, when Pastor Walt Kallestad and Pastor Paul Sorensen and I preached about 9/11, there have been sermons that have come in the aftermath of many different mass killings. And while I love to preach and while I love to bring the gospel to people, there is a certain weight that a pastor carries in these moments when we're called upon to preach the gospel in times when we're all really captivated by some sort of tragedy or difficulty. We're in a really unique setting right now. This is different than anything I've experienced before. We have this trifecta, so to speak, of the pandemic that has taken so many lives and continues to take lives. The economic downturn as a result of it, and now racial tension rising up to the top. I was listening to a pastor yesterday. He's from a large church, a younger guy, at least younger than me. He's probably in his 30s or 40s, and he was saying that one of the things that has happened over the last 3 months is that pastors have had to become experts in how to do online church, experts in the pandemic, in knowing how it spreads, whether people should wear face masks or not when they reopen their churches, and now they have to be experts when it comes to racism. And I can promise you that Pastor Kathleen and I are doing all that we can to stay current. But at a certain point, even we reach it, where we're now above our pay grade. And so I have been thinking all week about this particular service, trying to come up with what are the words that will convey to us who will call this church our home, what's going on in our world right now. And I decided that rather than use my words, that Pastor Kathleen and I would share the words of others. And so we're going to call on the grace of all of us and the trust of all of us to share some heartfelt words that I believe God wants us to hear and wants us to wrestle with and wants us to respond to. And so before we share those words with you, let me pray with us. Gracious God, I pray that you would grace us with the eyes to see and the ears to hear. The eyes to see what you see, the ears to hear what you hear, and to respond with grace as you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. One day Moses was tending the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led the flock far into the wilderness and came to Sinai, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from the middle of a bush. Moses stared in amazement. Though the bush was engulfed in flames, it didn't burn up. "This is amazing," Moses said to himself. "Why isn't that bush burning up? I must go see it." When the Lord saw Moses coming to take a closer look, God called to him from the middle of the bush, "Moses, Moses." "Here I am," Moses replied. "Do not come any closer," the Lord warned. "Take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." When Moses heard this, he covered his face because he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord told him, "I have certainly seen the oppression of my people in Egypt. I have heard their cries of distress."
I can't breathe. George Floyd. To be black in America for many means becoming a hashtag. Hashtag free somebody, or hashtag somebody has just passed away. And being black in this country is a perpetual sense of grief. You can either be racist or anti-racist. Those are the only two choices, because these systems of oppression are killing people, are killing black folk. People are tired of this. Bakary Sellers, attorney and author, whose father, Cleveland Sellers, was shot during a 1968 protest at South Carolina State University.
When I heard there were rumors about violent protests in Atlanta, I did what a mother would do. I called my son and I said, "Where are you?" I said, "I cannot protect you, and black boys shouldn't be out today." Keisha Lance Bottoms, mayor of Atlanta.
I'm angry, I'm afraid, and I'm in pain. When I read those words, I feel like I'm channeling one of my kids. These are the words of a teenager lost and looking for direction in a messed up world, not the sentiment of an NBA head coach and former player. We're supposed to have all the answers. We're supposed to be seen as grace under pressure. We're supposed to lead by example. Still, I am angry, afraid, and in pain. I don't have all the answers, but I know the solutions start with love, listening, compassion, service, and defending those who can't defend themselves. I'm distraught as I look at my boys. Two are African-American and one is Caucasian, because too many people see them differently. None of them should have to think about how law enforcement will treat them if pulled over for rolling through a stop sign. None of them should be followed through a department store by security. None of them should feel the sweat rolling down their backs when a cop follows them for blocks. Alas, their worlds are different and something is wrong with that. Don't misread me. I have as much respect for most law enforcement as I do disdain for some of the would-be protesters. To those who have sworn to protect and serve all people, regardless of color, religion, or sexual orientation, I say thank you. We have an institutional problem with pervasive racism. It must end now. Borrowing from C.S. Lewis, you can't go back and change the beginning, but you can start where you are and change the ending. We must be the change now. Monty Williams, head coach, Phoenix Suns.
As a black woman raised in a predominantly white neighborhood, predominantly white church, predominantly white school, and predominantly white society, my circle of friends is predominantly white. In fact, I have no close black friends. I have a few people of color that I consider confidants, but none of them are black. I'm very blessed to have had more opportunities than most. You see, my wonderful, educated parents knew that an education was the key to success as a black American. They encouraged all five of their children to get a college education, and all five of us graduated from college. Several of us went on to get advanced degrees. I chose to pursue a career as an attorney and have been practicing law for more than 17 years. That has afforded me more luxuries and opportunities than many other black Americans. There is no doubt that I am one of the lucky ones, but make no mistake, those blessings have not shielded me from the racism that exists in our country. I still have people following me in the store when I go shopping because they think I am going to steal. I have people refuse to help me at the makeup counter at the department store. I have been cursed at and called the N-word. To this day, I dress up to go shopping at the mall because I have learned there is a better likelihood that a store associate will help me when I look nice. My parents have had to intervene with teachers who failed to treat me the same as other students when I was in school trying to get an education like everyone else. When I was young, my parents had the talk with all of us. If you get pulled over, keep your hands on the wheel, obey everything they tell you, be respectful, and do not talk back. When you enter a building, including a church, you survey the area and look people in the eye to gauge their reaction to you. Do they believe that you do not belong there? Watch your back. I worry every day about the safety of my brother, my uncles, my cousins, my family, myself. My experiences do not diverge far from what you have seen and heard on television in recent days. I have the same ancestors as all the men and women that have been savagely and unjustly murdered because of the color of their skin. Their people are my people. I am black. Carlotta Terman, lawyer and member of Community of Grace.
What was your first reaction when you saw the video of the white cop kneeling on George Floyd's neck while Floyd croaked, "I can't breathe"? If you're white, you probably muttered a horrified, "Oh my God," while shaking your head at the cruel injustice. If you're black, you probably leapt to your feet, cursed, maybe threw something, certainly wanted to throw something, while shouting, "Not blankety blank again." Then you remember the two white vigilantes accused of murdering Ahmaud Arbery as he jogged through their neighborhood in February, and how if it wasn't for that video emerging a few weeks ago, they would have gotten away with it. And how those Minneapolis police cops claimed Floyd was resisting arrest, but a store's video showed he wasn't. And how the cop on Floyd's neck wasn't an enraged redneck stereotype, but a sworn officer who looked calm and entitled and devoid of pity, the banality of evil incarnate. Maybe you also were thinking about the Karen in Central Park who called 911 claiming the black man who asked her to put a leash on her dog was threatening her. Or the black Yale University grad student napping in the common room of her dorm who was reported by a white student. Because you realize it's not just a supposed black criminal who is targeted, it's the whole spectrum of black faces from Yonkers to Yale. I don't want to see stores looted or even buildings burn, but African Americans have been living in a burning building for many years, choking on the smoke as the flames burn closer and closer. Racism in America is like the dust in the air. It seems invisible, even if you're choking on it, until you let the sun in. Then you see it's everywhere. As long as we keep shining that light, we have the chance of cleaning it wherever it lands, but we have to stay vigilant because it's always still in the air. Police put a gun to my head at 12. Tired of reading about racism, I'm tired of living it. What I want to see is not a rush to judgment, but a rush to justice. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, NBA basketball star. Dude, I gotta tell you, the George Floyd incident in Minnesota hurt. I cried when I saw that video, it broke me down. The knee on the neck is a metaphor for how the system so cavalierly holds back black folks down, ignoring the cries for help. People don't care. Truly tragic. African-American man to President Barack Obama. It's natural to wish for life, to get back to normal, as a pandemic and economic crisis upend everything around us. But we have to remember that for millions of Americans, being treated differently on account of race is tragically, painfully, and maddeningly normal. Whether it's while dealing with the healthcare system or interacting with the criminal justice system or jogging down the street or just watching birds in a park. This shouldn't be normal in 2020 America. It can't be normal. If we want our children to grow up as a nation, in a nation that lives up to its highest ideals, we can and must be better. President Barack Obama.
I can't breathe. George Floyd.
I have heard their cries of distress. God. Jesus had this remarkable ability to tell stories about God and God's grace that upended every preconceived idea we had about who God is. And not only did Jesus tell stories about this radical grace of God, but he acted out in many ways of this grace of God, by healing the sick and giving sight to the blind, by eating with the wrong kinds of people and feeding the hungry. But perhaps his most compelling symbolic act of what God is like outside of the cross happened just a few hours before he went to the cross. Jesus was celebrating the Passover meal with his disciples. That's the meal that the Jews celebrate every year. That meal from thousands of years ago, where God heard the cries of distress of his people and acted by setting the people free from slavery in Egypt. And Jesus did something shocking in that moment. He took off his outer clothes, he picked up a towel, he picked up a bowl of water, and he took a knee. Now, the disciples had no idea what he was doing. And they were outraged. I know you can remember the outrage so many of us had a few years ago when Colin Kaepernick took a knee along with many other NFL players during the national anthem. We didn't understand what he was doing. We were outraged. It seemed so disrespectful. And the disciples of Jesus felt the exact same way. Jesus had put himself in a position of the lowest of the low, and they weren't going to tolerate it. In fact, Peter said, "Jesus, get up. You're not going to wash my feet." And that's when Jesus said, "This is what love looks like. This is the position of power that changes the world. This is the epicenter of grace. This is what love looks like. Follow me." I invite you to join me as we pray together. Lord Jesus, who reached across the ethnic boundaries of Samaritan, Roman, and Jew, who offered fresh sight to the blind and freedom to captives, help us to break down the barriers in our community. Give us the courage to hear the cries of the oppressed, enable us to see the reality of racism and bigotry, and free us to challenge and uproot it from ourselves, our society, and our world. Amen. As we get ready to celebrate communion, we're going to take a moment, do a song for you, let you get yourself ready to receive the body and blood of Jesus.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender, suffered and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light, forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe of Jesus. I believe in you. I believe you rose again. I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe.
Would you please join me in confessing what we believe through the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let's pray the words of the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I now invite you to share the bread with others around you with the words, "The body of Christ given for you." And if you are seated physically by yourself, yet gathered with us by the Spirit, I say these words to you, "The body of Christ given for you." I now invite you to share the cup. You may use the words, "The blood of Christ shed for you." And if you are seated physically by yourself in this moment, yet with us just the same, I say these words to you, "The blood of Christ shed for you."
And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you unto everlasting life. Peace be with you. Amen. Thanks again for worshiping with us this weekend. And if you didn't get a chance to hit the watch party and want to share this service, in just a moment, we're going to hang up on you, so to speak. And at that point, you can share this on your Facebook page and invite more people to watch along with us as we worship together this weekend. A few things we want you to know before we sign off. I want to bring up for you once again that new text phone number that we have for you, 602-806-9406. If you would like more information about the church, text the word "welcome" to that phone number. If you have a prayer request or would like pastoral care, you can type that phone number in and then put the word "prayer" in the text, hit send. Same for events. That will tell you some of the things that are going on here. And if you're interested in our Vacation Bible School, which is just a couple weeks away now, you can do 602-806-9406 and type in VBS in the message and hit send, and we will make sure that we get information to you, and we'd like to have you and your family participate with us in that. A couple other things that I want you to know about. Every Monday through Friday, we do prayer time together at 6 o'clock on Facebook. Monday night, prayer time. Tuesday night, we're going to do something a little different. Tuesday night, we're going to have our worship time with Tony and Lisa. Wednesday night, I'm going to continue my Bible study on the Psalms. Thursday night, I'm going to be doing an interview with Dr. Warren Stuart. He and I did an interview back in November on racism, and he and I are going to check in light of what's been going on here in our country in the last couple weeks. So that will be Thursday night, and then Friday night, Pastor Kathleen will be leading us in our prayer time. And then next weekend, we're going to be continuing our series, "Normal Doesn't Live Here Anymore." And that, I think, marks the officially 3 months of being online for church. And so next Sunday evening, we're going to be doing a Grace Town Hall. And during that virtual town hall, it's going to be a live event on Facebook. I'm going to talk a little bit about where we are with our reopening. But more than that, just talk in broad strokes about what it looks like to be the church going forward, because the world really has changed. And some of the trends that we're seeing, some of the things that we as staff are thinking about in terms of being a church together, particularly when we come back into this building, and we're looking for your input as well. So that's going to be a virtual town meeting, townhouse meeting, what do they call those things? Whatever it is, town hall meeting, Grace Town Hall, and that will be next Sunday. So what date is that? June 13th? 14th? Thank you, June 14th. And that will be at 6 o'clock Sunday night. They'll be live on Facebook. And if you can't join us for that, of course, it will be available for you after we do the live stream on that. So as you go now, may our loving Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face smile upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord always turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.